So,
Hello,
hello,
everyone.
my name is Yuris, and today we will talk about infrastructure as a code. Before we start, I would like to mention that this presentation is available online. Just follow the link which you see, I hope you see on the screen, and you will be redirected to this presentation. Talking about myself, more than 10 years in IT, started as a system administrator. For the last 5 years, mainly was working with Azure. I also have a GitHub account. There I'm trying to store useful information about Azure or Azure-related information. So if you want, you can check it and see maybe something useful you could find for yourself. And yeah, so now let's talk about infrastructure as a code. Few things come in my mind when I'm thinking about infrastructure as a code. Main of them are following. First of all, no snowflakes. Snowflake is an environment which was managed manually. So someone has installed it, patched, configured it. And main problem with that approach is that it's really hard to reproduce that environment. No one actually remembers what exactly they need to do and how exactly it was configured. And second part of infrastructure as a code is the approach which is used to deploy it. It could be declarative or and it could be imperative. Main thing here I would say is the answer to which answer one or another approach. Declarative answer to a question what exactly you want to get. Imperative at the same time answer to question how you want to get it. A good example from real life is whenever you go to a restaurant, if you remember those times when you was allowed to do so, you could order from the menu. This means that you don't specify exactly which ingredients you would like to use. You are choosing from menu, and that is declarative approach. At the same time, if you go to the shop, buy all necessary ingredients, and cook by yourself, that is imperative approach. So yeah. And remembering about that, I came in my team to the following structure. It have multiple abstraction layers. We will start from bottom to top and talk about every layer separately. As you may have heard, I'm working most of the time with Microsoft Cloud. And important thing here is that actually currently we are using, if you are using Microsoft Azure, you are using the latest version of that cloud. Originally, it was called Azure Service Manager. And the main problem with that version was that you had following structure. You had subscriptions, and in those subscriptions, you got services. And providing access to separate services was a big challenge, let's say. So after some period of time, Microsoft came with a newest version of its cloud. It's called Azure Resource Manager. And here we don't have a service, we have a resource. Resource is more than service, it has meta information about itself. And the following structure was announced. Now you have resource, which is stored in resource group, which is a part of the subscription. You can have one or multiple subscriptions and only one tenant. Good example from real life is your computer. Same structure. You can have only one computer. Well, basically, you can have more, but for every computer is like a tenant. So you can change it, but still it's only one thing, and it's basically one of the main things of Azure. And you can have one or multiple disks. Each of those disks can have one or multiple folders, and you can store one or multiple files in those folders. Same goes to the Azure. So the here main thing is that you actually can grant access to different teams by and giving them access to on the different level. For example, one team can have access to specific resource group, and another team could have access to the whole subscription or to only one resource. And access itself could be different. You can grant contributor role, you can grant owner role, so you can grant read-only role. What was first thing related to newest version of Microsoft Cloud? Second thing was that now actually every resource which you using in Azure is basically just endpoint to which you can communicate using JSON format. Whatever you are using, Azure Portal, Azure CLI, PowerShell, or any other tool, at the end of the day, you are communicating with the API endpoint. And API endpoint knows how to deal with following JSON schema. Basically, you see six parts of this format. But main of them are only three. It's parameters, variables, and resources. Parameters is values which you can specify for during every deploy, and you can change it. Variables are immutable values which you cannot change during the deployment, but you can hard code it in your ARM template and use it later for creating resources. And resources itself is just basically a description of what resources you want to deploy. And that is all. It's not so difficult. I know that not so many people actually enjoy working with JSON format and especially with ARM templates. But there are a few advantages of doing that. One of them is that ARM template is based on declarative approach. So you can have your ARM template and you can redeploy it as many times as you want. Still, you should get the same environment every time you're doing that. Yeah, so that is the base structure of my infrastructure as a code approach. And of course, it's strictly defined to the cloud itself. Not every cloud have such way of communicating with it and managing it actually. But this file has its own limitations. You cannot use more than 4 megabytes for it. Amount of parameters, variables, and resources is also limited. And the pipelines in this case, it's, I would say, difficult way of dealing with environment. So specifying multiple templates one by one, just from template itself, you can do it, but it's quite difficult. Because of that, in our team, we are using Ansible. Ansible is a registration tool. Maybe some of you have heard about it. It was developed originally by Red Hat. It's open sourced, and it contains basically three main parts. This registration tool is agentless, so you don't need to have some running agent on managed environment to be able to manage it. It is decentralized. You don't have master node. Any computer with installed specific environment could be used as a control node to manage your environment. And it has three parts. First of all, it's playbook. Playbook is basically the instruction set, what exactly you want to do. It uses YAML format. So yeah, and nothing more to say. Main thing to be able to run it, it's Ansible engine, and Ansible engine uses modules. Every module is for a specific purpose. So if your playbook needs something to manage Azure, you need to use Azure module for that. And managed environment could be anything. It could be Linux virtual machine, it could be Windows virtual machine, it could be cloud, as it is in our use case. And yeah, so you can install everything you need and basically just execute the playbook, which will run the ARM template. But here comes one related question. You already need ARM template itself, you need playbook, you need Ansible engine, and you need module for running that Ansible module. And on top of that, Ansible is running on Linux, so you need specific OS for that. To resolve this question, this limitation, we are using Docker. Maybe some of you have heard there are different type of virtualization. There is a hypervisor virtualization, which require from you hardware support, and there is a container virtualization. Main benefit from my point of view, if you're talking about containers, is the fact that you don't need to manage an operating system. You just package all dependencies, all environment in your Docker image, and use that to running the containers. And yeah, basically structure looks following. To be able to run Docker container, you need to prepare a Docker image. To build a Docker image, you need to use Docker file and Docker engine. Basically, you just take all your dependencies, store them in Docker file, and using Docker image, Docker engine, build a Docker image. That is all. Now you have an environment which you can run from anywhere. There you have a Docker engine, of course. I'm running it from my computer. At the same time, I could use a Azure Container Instance to run it, and actually we are doing that. You can use any kind of environment, basically, as I said, and all dependencies are there in place, and you don't need to think about it, to take care about that question. Here the thing is, but for doing that, for building the Docker image, we are using Azure DevOps. Azure DevOps is a version control system provided by Microsoft. Name is a little bit misleading, but still, it is how it is. And basically, if you are managing infrastructure as a code, that is logical, but you are storing your infrastructure configuration as a code and building it also as a code. And for that, we are using basically Git and Azure DevOps pipelines. So using Azure DevOps, we at the same time building a golden image and running it at another pipeline in the same repository. Optionally, in our environment, we started to use Power Automate. Power Automate, it's basically graphical user interface. Again, this tool is originally provided from Microsoft, and it allows you to integrate different kinds of applications and services using basically with no code. Everything is drag and drop. Maybe you have heard another name of this product. It's called Azure Logic App. It's almost the same, but Azure Logic Apps, first of all, are stored resources in Microsoft Azure. So you can store it together with your, you can access them to the, from the same portal as you access. Site, you need a license to be able to run it, and yeah, basically it's allow you to build a user interface. In our case, if you need to start and you need to specify some parameters, you are using Power Automate. If you just need the start a deployment which doesn't have parameters, it also is an option you can also make. And so, yeah, basically, in my case, infrastructure is following. At the beginning, we build some template. We are packaging in Ansible playbook, and together with Ansible engine and Ansible engine, we are packaging using as a Docker image. That image we are running on the same repository in another pipeline. One of the important thing is, maybe you are wondering why we are using ARM templates. If we could use just pure, actually, Azure modules for Ansible, the list is quite big. I see two problems with that. First of all, not every resource which is available on Azure is present that module. And for example, I know that not only problem with Ansible. I got recently situation where announced private endpoint, private API for Azure. And guys who was using Terraform wasn't able to use that, as Terraform didn't have that feature yet, as it was still on bed. Remember. So yeah, you basically, module will have required functionality. And second thing is, which I also think is important, is that in this picture, I can replace playbooks with something else. Even more, if, for example, I see that deployment, I don't know, something was crashed, maybe, I don't know, Ansible engine is broken, or module should be updated, I can use the same ARM template from my computer. I can go to the portal and deploy ARM template there. I can use another tool. In the future, we will understand that Ansible is not a good solution for registration. We can replace it with something else. And we don't need to redeploy, rewrite everything. We will just need to change that part which we are using to start the deployment. And the configuration of our environment still are ARM template, and that is very important. And that is main reasons why I believe ARM templates is good to use for building our environment. So we have made Docker image. Colleagues are just using Power Automate, are running Ansible playbooks, which are basically deploying current templates. And they don't know anything about Ansible, about Docker itself. They just know how to deal, for example, that, again, it's a network-related configuration, so how to, which IP address to use, on which subscription to do that, etc. But this approach, this combination of them to not think about how it works, how it actually works inside. So abstracting that really helps in my team. I hope so, at least. Yeah, and so main benefit from that is that it now we anyway, if you want to redeploy something, sometimes Azure just breaks because it breaks, and the only thing which you have left is to redeploy it. And it's run some scripts or click something, you just in one place start whatever you need to do. Less configuration drift. We basically using, we have a production environment and we have test environment, development environment. And for both types of environment, we are using same. Reduce of human factor, of course, we don't have snowflakes. We don't have environment which is configured manually, which means that less errors could be made, because main source of errors between chair and computer most of the times. And also, as I said before, using basically Power Automate in this particular use case, with automation, not only the people who are working with writing playbooks and templates, but also people who are not aware of those technologies. At the same time, such solution is that you have additional environment which you need to handle. With the time you need to update, for example, to the latest version software which you are running, like Azure, like Ansible. So yeah, you not Docker, but Ansible engines and ARM template most of the time. If some new features appear in Docker which would be useful, in our case probably we'll also utilize that. And maintenance is not only to maintenance the environment using Pepe in our case, but also you need to manage those playbooks. And sometimes it took just huge amount of time to understand how you need to deploy one or another thing. But as I said, this approach has also great benefits from that. Thank you very much for listening. I hope you enjoyed my presentation. I theoretically described how exactly we are structured in my team, but if you want to try it by yourself, you can follow the link, and of technology is presented there with real environment, like Docker file. So you can check it and see and try it and even deploy if you have Azure subscription. So as I mentioned before, I provided here my main repository where I'm storing information about Azure. So if you want, you can take a look on that. I'm trying to write small, let's say, articles going on Azure. Maybe something could be useful also for you. And if you you can do it on the same GitHub account. I created a discussion, so you can leave anything you want to leave there, or in the chat. I also will read it now. And if you enjoyed my presentation, or if you enjoy my repository, I would to click on the star button or watch button. It really makes me feel good knowing what the thing which I am doing could be useful for someone else. Yeah, so, and now answer your questions if you have some.